Our next speaker is Professor Melissa Breger. She's been teaching at Albany Law School for 17 years. I'm sorry, she's been teaching at the law school level for 17 years, first at the University of Michigan Law School, which Michigan Law School affiliation she shares with our afternoon speaker, I believe, Judith Olin. Is that correct?
I taught at the clinic there for 11 years.
Okay. Well, that's small world to me. Professor Breger is the recipient of several teaching and service awards, both on a local level and on a national level. Her bio, of course, is in your materials, so I want to focus on what Professor Breger does now, which is teaching a variety of courses at Albany Law School, including evidence, family law, criminal procedure, investigation. She's taught a domestic violence seminar. She's taught gender in the law and children in the law. She was the director of the Family Violence Litigation Clinic from 2002 to 2010. So that's an 8-year stint. That's a very long time. And I have seen no evidence of compassion fatigue in Professor Breger. Please join me in welcoming her.
Thank you, Judge. And thank you all for inviting me. This is actually my first time in Buffalo. So I am excited to try what the hotel calls buffalo wing soup, which is supposed to taste just like a buffalo wing. We shall see. So today I want to talk to you about my research about culture, specifically the culture, what I call the culture of domestic violence that I believe we have in this country, and what it means, why it's important, how we might think about instrumentally changing it, if that's possible. And I'm going to discuss how the legal system and case law have played a role in contributing to this culture and how ultimately the legal system might be able to help us transform the culture. So what do I mean by culture? So the concept of culture itself is multi-layered. There's thousands of definitions out there. Popular uses of the term culture are thrown about: corporate culture, ethnic culture, subculture, mainstream culture, popular culture, just to name a few. And many of these ideas sort of intersect with each other. Georgetown Law School professor Naomi Mazie has appropriately remarked that the notion of culture is everywhere invoked, but virtually nowhere explained. The way that I will be talking about culture for today is sort of just our set of informal norms and rules of behavior, our perceptions in society. And the focus of my talk today is that our modern day American society, or really Western society, has a culture of gender violence. And I posit that that trickles down into a culture that condones or at least allows intimate partner violence much more readily than it should. When I'm going to be talking about gender violence and domestic violence, I am going to be using gender terms. Certainly, as we have talked about, there is domestic violence across the board, men, women, children. But the data is clear that the majority of at least the reported cases of domestic violence are oftentimes men as to women. And what I'm trying to talk about is sort of how the legal system has viewed women specifically vis-a-vis men. So I will be talking in gender terms, but not ignoring the fact that it's been an epidemic of violence across the board in all relationships and all genders. Anytime that one person thinks it's okay to exert power and control over another human being via violence would count. Now, many of us have heard of the term rape culture. It's been making the headlines in recent times. And traditionally, this is the idea that the over-sexualization and subjugation of women and girls in society gets us to the point where, for some, rape is either inevitable or just a fact of life. In fact, the actual term rape culture, was coined by a sociologist by the name of Diane Herman. And she describes it as such: the causal debasement of women that has become such a part of our lives that it is often invisible. And she goes on to say that it's one in which we presume that sexual violence against women is not only a fact of life, but is as inevitable as death or taxes. Gloria Steinem also talks about sexual violence against women and being due to a cult of gender, a cult of masculinity. She explains that it's the most difficult to challenge because it is just exaggerated versions of the earliest ways we may have been taught to see people as groups rather than as unique individuals. I'll talk more about that when we talk about implicit biases. But the question I ask here is rather rhetorical. Do we also, in addition to a culture of rape in our society, do we also have a culture of domestic violence? It's no secret that, to answer my own question, I believe we do. I believe that our society too readily accepts intimate partner violence and abuse against family members as either being acceptable, inevitable, or just part of a relationship. And beyond that, our culture is also so steeped in victim blaming. Dr. Jaffe talked about the skepticism. Well, if it's so bad, doctor, why didn't she just leave? Why did she go back to him? And we all know from being in this field that that's the million-dollar question that is asked and is used to kind of cut against, well, it couldn't have been that bad, right? Now, there was a recent study out of Sweden that compiled data from 100 countries. And what the study looked at was, what are the perceptions of violence against women? Is it acceptable? And then they tracked how the laws actually treated domestic violence. So it was really fascinating. Let me tell you some of the statistics first. In 29 countries around the world, one-third or more of men say it can be acceptable for a husband to beat his wife. In 19 countries, one-third or more of women say that a husband is allowed to beat his wife at least some of the time and is often justified. In the small country of Rwanda, 96% of the women say the practice is justified or can be justified. About two-thirds of women in India and South Africa feel the same way. I recently watched a documentary put out by the New York Times that was quite chilling. In the South Pacific island nation of Papua New Guinea, nearly every single woman on the island has experienced some form of domestic violence. Now, the country is just starting to put laws on the books to stop violence, and they're trying to track whether or not that's actually going to have an effect on whether or not the violence is still occurring. But the attitude of acceptance of violence against women is held by large percentages of women in countries all across the religious spectra, cultural, all across really the globe, whether it's China, Egypt, Iraq, Nigeria, Peru, the Philippines, Uzbekistan, there the majority of women believe it is appropriate and sometimes justified for husbands to beat their wives. And in our very own country of the United States, 1 in 10 women from America find it acceptable for husbands to beat wives. In Germany, it's 1 of 5. So this is really across all countries. Now, when I talk about culture in a little bit of a different way, popular culture, I kind of feel like we have to at least acknowledge how much popular culture has played a role in sort of how we see the world, especially for our young people. We think about social media, TV, music, and so on. And what you see, and it's alarming if you really look closely, is that not only is domestic violence acceptable in sort of popular culture, but oftentimes it's glorified. And these are the young people who are listening to this and watching this, and it's glorified. Just some examples, and there are many, but just a couple I picked up. Lana Del Rey has an album called Ultraviolence, in which she compares getting hit to a kiss, in which she asks her lover to give her all of that ultraviolence amid the call of sirens. K. Katy Perry, in the famous song E.T., tells an alien, "Take me, I want to be your victim, I'm ready for abduction." Even songs that are perhaps trying to raise awareness about domestic violence. So for a long time, the song "I Love the Way You Lie" with Rihanna and Eminem was seen as a song to expose the realities of domestic violence, and it very well may have been the intention. But the lyrics are raw and violent. And when you have young people who don't understand the nuances of domestic violence, belting them out, they sound an awful lot like it's being glorified, even though that might not have been the intent. And it made me think about back when I was growing up and how much I love that song from The Police, "Every Move You Make, I'll Be Watching You," and how it didn't really seem creepy at the time, though now it's really creepy, right? But we just didn't think about it because, you know, you kind of just sing mindlessly and, you know, you enjoy the beat and then you think, what am I really singing? But what I worry about is our young folks, right? Because we can all look at that and you know, analyze it, but not our young people. And I won't have a chance to talk about it today, but there was a recent case that went up to the United States Supreme Court called Elenis that maybe some of you know of. And under the guise of lyrics, the batterer wrote just the most vile, violent words, and then he put them online when he knew his wife would see them. And then when he was confronted by law enforcement, he said, "It was just music. I was being creative," right? And there wasn't much to say. In fact, the Supreme Court agreed with him, First Amendment rights. Some of the less offensive words I'll tell you, there's a whole lot of them, but there's one way to love you, but 1,000 ways to kill you. I'm not going to rest until your body is a mess, soaked in blood and dying from all of the little cuts. Fold up your protection from abuse order and put it in your pocket. Is it thick enough to stop a bullet? That's what the batterer put online, knowing his wife would see it, and then said, those were just lyrics. I was writing a song. But yet we see those lyrics on Top 40. Right? And on the other side of the spectrum, or maybe some variety of it, it's almost like there's a minimizing of domestic violence, almost like we're treating it as it's kind of inevitable. It's kind of an everyday part of our relationships. If you talk to young people, if you talk to teenagers, they sort of chuckle at the thought that their boyfriends and girlfriends will stalk them. You know, he texted me hundreds of times today, or he has a GPS on my phone. It's because he loves me, right? It's glamorous. It's that stalking means that that person loves you so much that they're just going to text you all day long. Reminds me of Dr. Jaffe's example of, you know, take a picture of where you are so I can track you. And I remember getting an invitation to a conference a few years ago, and the title of the conference was called "It's No Joke: The Cultural Acceptability of Stalking." And that was startling to me because even though in my mind I thought we do have a strange acceptability of it, there it was, as you know, billed as a conference, which just made sense that this is not just a thought I had, that this is something we have to reckon with. And imagine the horror on my face when my then 9-year-old daughter says to me, "Mom, I hope you're not going to be one of those stalker moms." What is a stalker mom? You know, those stalker moms who watch everything you do. So again, this idea, this scary crime of domestic violence has just means something else to our young people. And it's become very much, you know, it's become sort of distorted, right? And what does that say about our culture if we're kind of joking around about stalking or finding it sexy, right? And so this is something we need to really think about. If society as a whole views domestic violence as somehow acceptable or inevitable, right, then where is the support in a society that's supporting that abuse, right? If somebody is trying to find that support, society is in some ways condoning it. Parents are less likely to teach their children to solve differences with words instead of their fists. Social norms and attitudes that underpin them really are the root cause of violence against women. And this really has been shown by much social research, that deeply embedded social norms about that we learn as children play into a narrative. They play into a narrative about how women are supposed to act or women are supposed to look, or intimate partners and relationships look a certain way, right? We learn that very, very young. And we learn that so young that oftentimes that contributes to a narrative by the time we reach adulthood. We don't even realize that's become sort of how we view relationships. For example, the more we grow up believing that men are one way and women are another way, and the more we grow up believing that it's okay to exercise power and control from one human being to another, and violence by one human being to another is sometimes okay, the more we're able to accept this is just how the world is. This is just society, right? And less able to try to really transform that. And these norms really then feed their way into implicit biases that we hold. And I'm going to talk about that in a moment. So my argument is that we really need to break these connections early and often so we are not becoming complacent about this culture of domestic violence. Oftentimes, we are really not aware of the types of assumptions we make every day, and not all of them are necessarily negative. So I just wanted to clarify, you know, and many of you, I'm sure, are well familiar with explicit bias versus implicit bias. And obviously, explicit bias is more openly expressed. Up until recently, I could say it was not condoned by society. I'm not sure I can still say that. But that would be examples, you know, just kind of the open stereotypes about a particular group of people that for a while was not, you know, not acceptable. Now it's not so clear. But unlike explicit biases, implicit biases do not always take the shape of an outward animosity or hatred towards a particular group. Sometimes implicit biases are positive. And my favorite example of this is that, you know, there's sort of this implicit bias that many of us have grown up in, where we believe that mothers are a certain way. Mothers are all-nurturing and selfless and caretakers and kind. How could that be bad? How could that be bad? We might even go far as to say they're superior at parenting, although I wouldn't say that in mixed company. But that's a good thing, right? How is that bad? Well, it's bad when we then expect mothers in our court system to be perfect mothers, of which nobody can live up to that, right? So you can take something that seems relatively innocuous and even positive, but show that when you have that belief as a child and it becomes cemented into your head, it actually can be harmful to real women, not, you know, to the real mother, not the, you know, hypothetical mother. And everybody has implicit biases. I mean, this is just, they're started young, they're often unconscious, they're often unintentional, and so they're really hard to identify. You don't always even know you have an implicit bias unless you take the implicit bias test. You know, Harvard has this great online test you can take, but you don't even necessarily know you have them. But the research shows that they form as young as 3 years old. So at 3 years old, when most of us can't quite even remember what we were eating, you know, we were getting sort of our versions of what the world looks like and the stereotypes, and that was embedded, those norms were embedded. And research also shows that as you get older, those implicit biases become more and more hardened into your belief system. Again, you may not even be aware of those. They may not be negative, but they nonetheless shade how you ultimately view the world, and in my opinion, how you view a relationship and what's an appropriate relationship. Further, especially in this age, we have been really faced on a number of levels with what is called toxic or hypermasculinity. And the idea of that is that many of our men are socialized early on to be dominant, competitive, unemotional, sexually aggressive, misogynistic. Certainly these values are in no way inherent to becoming a man. Yet, this is often how we raise and socialize our boys. Don't cry, you know, be tough, whatever it may be. So from a young age, boys are taught that displays of human emotion can be unacceptable, about sex being conquest and power and status, and their value and worthiness as men. And so because that is out there, not certainly not to say that all or even many men fall into that, but we have to be thinking about, again, how are we teaching these young people without even being aware of it, what is considered acceptable? More on this later. I just want to reiterate, it is clearly, it just bears repeating, I mean, domestic violence crosses across all genders, sexual orientations, races, cultures, religions, abilities. It is a real problem in our country and across the world. But the reality is that the number of reported domestic violence crimes are overwhelmingly male, perpetrators against female. Again, there's a problem with data. You know, we know data, it's about who's reported. But the numbers are so high, 90th percentiles, that we have to talk about this as a gender issue as well. More than 1 in 4 women worldwide have experienced physical or sexual violence at the hand of an intimate partner. In sub-Saharan Africa, the share is about 2 out of every 3. In North America, it's 1 out of every 5. Our younger women and girls are at highest risk within our own country. American girls and young women between the ages of 16 and 24 experience the highest rate of intimate partner violence, a rate almost triple the national average. Professor Catherine McKinnon notes that just because domestic violence and rape can happen to both sexes does not make it any less of a gender issue. So we do have to think of it in those terms. There are these deeply gendered norms that we grow up with in our society, and there becomes this idea that domination, control of women is somewhat inevitable. And even though we might shun that explicitly, again, we are all kind of carrying around with us the implicit biases that normalize it. There's been recently some social norms research, which I'll talk about in a moment, but oftentimes men overestimate other men's acceptance of abusive behavior towards women and underestimate other men's willingness to intervene when a woman is experiencing violence. And what the norms research found was that when these men and boys believe that their peers accept sexist and abusive behavior, they're less likely to help. And that in turn can lead to a pretty dangerous cycle. Now, how does the law fit in? How does the law fit into all of this? Well, we can't ignore the patriarchal roots of the law. Certainly there's been some explicit connection, and there has certainly been implicit as well. The term domestic violence wasn't even a term for such a long time, until the late 20th century. Same with marital rape. I mean, and many of you know that even as of recently, marital rape was still on the books, but it wasn't called such. The early Roman laws of chastisement and the rule of thumb are really instructive in learning how the law has played a role into this culture. It was acceptable and allowed for husbands to beat their wives as an appropriate punishment to prevent them from exposing their husband to criminal and civil liability. The only restriction the Roman government imposed upon the husband was that the circumference of the rod or switch had to be no greater than the width of the husband's thumb. And this was how we have the term rule of thumb. That it was okay to beat your wife as long as the rod or switch you used was no greater than the girth of your thumb. In the coverture theory, we moved away from these laws of chastisement into England's laws and the idea that women became a part of a man when they married. So you were two people, and when you married, you became the man. And the interests are essentially merged into one person. So when the husband would assault his wife, he was merely assaulting himself. He could not be arrested or charged with crime because he was just hurting himself. At best, the women or children in his life were the chattel. And so you found that the law early on was not treating any kind of violence within a family as a crime at all. Because when you're in a family, you are just one. Now, obviously, that is a long time ago. So how has the law looked at it recently? Well, I want to talk about a couple of cases, and these are in your materials, to talk about how far we've come and in some ways how far we haven't come. The first case I'm actually going out of order. I apologize. I'll put them all up there. The first case I'll talk about was the Bruno v. Codd case. And this was a class action case that was brought against NYPD and the family courts in New York City in 1976. And the idea was it was that the police department was systematically refusing to enforce orders of protection. Police officers would be called to the scene of the crime, oftentimes even if there was physical evidence of an assault. And oftentimes the officers had the batterer walk around the block or told the wife that they're really unable to render any assistance or make an arrest because you're married or you're together. And because of that, there's really no room in the criminal system for you. You can go off to family court. So women were routinely sent over to family court because the police were saying this is a family matter, it's not a crime. And this is 1970, so not too long ago. Then when the women would go to family court, they would encounter the front desk, probation department employees, who would often fail to advise the women of their rights legally. Instead of having the women seen by the judges that day, which is the right, the clerks would say, come back to court weeks or months later. Women were also told incorrectly that they could not obtain orders of protection if the assault has already occurred, which in most cases, that is the case. And these were folks that were at the front desk of the family court, so to some sense were the gatekeepers, to filing a petition for family court. So the class action was brought, and it was again brought against many different defendants, but the NYPD and family court and so on. And ultimately, the trial court in the case said, if the allegations of this instant complaint, which is buttressed by hundreds of pages of affidavits, are true, then only the written law has changed. And the reality, in reality, wife beating is still condoned, if not approved, by some of those charged with protecting its victims. Ultimately, the High Court ultimately dismissed the case because the parties entered into a consent decree. More on that at another time. But that's an important case to know about. That was just not that long ago here in New York. The Morrison, U.S. v. Morrison case, also in your materials, was a federal case that tried to tap into a remedy in VAWA, Violence Against Women Act. There, a college freshman was raped by two university football players at Virginia Tech. Now, at the time, there was a federal law that created a remedy where if the victim could prove that the violent act was motivated by hatred or animus towards gender, they could be relieved in this remedy. So what Ms. Morrison tried, or I'm sorry, what the victim, the plaintiff tried to show is that because in the campus cafeteria, there was constantly misogynistic language, there was constantly talk about sexual conquests that was very anti-women. She tried to show that this, in fact, was part of the culture of the football team and part of the culture, and that therefore the rape that happened was part of a gender-motivated violence. The United States Supreme Court not only did they not grant her the relief, they in fact struck down the relevant part of VAWA as unconstitutional. Year 2000, our highest court. As we know, as we've now seen, from the earliest of times when the rule of thumb was created and there was these sort of anti-women laws, we haven't come too far even in 2000. But there is hope. There are some positive developments. The idea of this is, where have we gone, where are we now, and where do we go? So how about now? New York has been at the front runner of a lot of really powerful cases that have helped domestic violence, and Dr. Jaffe mentioned one of them. And I'm going to talk about them. Again, they're in your materials as well. But let me share some positive things that the law has done. 13 years after Bruno v. Codd, in 1992, the New York legislature created the Office of the Prevention of Domestic Violence, the first and only state agency of its kind. We'll hear from its director, Gwen White. 2 years later, passed laws that increase protections to victims of domestic violence. Cases such as Wissink came out. Wissink is a powerful case, not because it tells us anything else that's not already in the law, but of the strong words that the appellate court used to the trial court, and the strong words and the psychological research that was built into the case and the opinion that really shined a light on some of these issues. And so I do want to spend a little bit of time talking about the case, if you're not familiar with it. In that case, it was a custody case between a mother and a father. The child was at the time 14 when they filed, but 16 at the time of the trial. And the violence perpetrated by the father against the mother was very severe and increasing, and oftentimes in front of the daughter. And at the trial, the same judge had heard both the family offense case, which is the civil order of protection case, and the custody case. So the same judge in Westchester had just heard facts and testimony about pretty horrific domestic violence that had occurred and in front of the child. But at the same time, at the custody trial, the teenager testified and said, this never happened. She denied the abuse, and she wants to live with her father. So the child court sent her to live with her father. Okay, and there was an attorney for the child who responded to that, and it was appropriate reaction. However, the appellate court reversed with some pretty damning language, and the second department said, were it not for the documented history of domestic violence confirmed by this court after a hearing, we would have unanimously affirmed the family court's award of custody to the father in accordance with Andrea's express preference and the evidence documenting their positive relationship. However, the fact of domestic violence should have been considered more than superficially, particularly in this case where Andrea expressed her unequivocal preference for the abuser while denying the very existence of domestic abuse that the court just found she witnessed. The record is replete with incidents of domestic violence reported by the mother and by evidence supporting her testimony. And I'll just go through some of the issues that were talked about. The earliest incident was when Andrea was merely an infant. She was being held in the arms of the mother. In a fit of anger, the father hit and kicked the mother, pulled out chunks of her hair while she held the baby, and then said, oh, well, she's going to die. Years later, when the child was a toddler, he attacked her, kicked, hitting, and strangling her, sustaining marks on her neck and sore throat. She repeatedly went to get orders of protection. In the fall of 1995, the father allegedly held a knife, 8 to 10 inches long, to the mother's throat while Andrea sat in her lap. This went on where the mother would leave and go to shelter and come back, and the abuse kept happening, and always in front of the child, or at least often in front of the child. The time that really bothered the court was in June of 1999. A few days after the mother had returned from a shelter with her daughter, there was a dispute between the parents over tax returns. And the mother put the tax returns in her mouth, kind of in her teeth, in order to keep them away from the father. And essentially, the father tried to grab the papers out and asked Andrea to please hold your mother's nose so she won't be able to breathe. This went on. And the court had just heard all of these situations. And so again, the courts, the appellate court said, the family court did not only entirely ignore the legislative mandate that says domestic violence must be considered in cases of custody. Just to note, we do not have the rebuttable presumption that Dr. Jaffe had mentioned in New York, but we do have a legislative mandate that says it must be considered. But not only that, but that the consideration afforded the effect of domestic violence in this case was, in our view, sorely inadequate. In a case like this, where the record reveals years of domestic violence, which is denied by the very child who witnessed it, and the child has expressed her preference to live with the abuser, the court should have ordered a comprehensive psychological evaluation. In this case, there was a 30-minute evaluation by the court staff. And the court goes on to explain what would have been in such an evaluation. Ultimately, the court said, if we were to hold otherwise, if we were to allow Andrea to stay with her father, quote, the child would have learned a dangerous and morally depraved lesson that abusive behavior is not only acceptable, but may even be rewarded. Nicholson v. Scapetta, we heard about from Dr. Jaffe as well. An enormously powerful case, also a class action case, in which many other states have looked to New York as a way of dealing with the issue. And ultimately finding that in this class action suit, where women were having their children removed from the home simply because that woman had been a victim of domestic violence, even when the women had done what they could to prevent it. In one case, one of the plaintiffs had an order of protection, but she allowed the ex-husband back into the home. Just briefly, she places her child in a locked bedroom, and the attack happens then. And with that, the court said she just should never have let him back in. So really not understanding the nuances of, as we talk about, sharing parenting and how that would work. And what would happen would be that these children would be removed into stranger foster care and taken away from their parents, from their mother. Now, it was a class action. It was a group of, I believe, eight mothers who brought the case against the city. Again, it was in New York City, against Child Protective. And it was brought in federal court. And Judge Weinstein wrote a compelling opinion. It was 189 pages. That is not in your materials. I didn't think you wanted to. You can look it up if you want, or I can send you the site, but I did not want to bury you in that. But he made six findings that talked about how the city regularly indicated child neglect against mothers and not fathers, regularly held rarely held abusers accountable, even though that was the reason the child might have been in danger, rarely offered services to these women, regularly separated them, and yet hadn't trained their employees on domestic violence and the nuances, didn't have policies in place, and ultimately he found that he certified the class action and it moved up. It ended up moving up through the federal courts, popped over to the New York highest court, and then back down. But the New York highest court was unanimous in its decision that the city was wrong in taking away children and placing them into foster care when the only thing that went on in the home was that the mother was a victim of domestic violence, and therefore they were doubly punished. The Court of Appeals ultimately talked about seven factors that trial courts need to think about. And some of these were mentioned already, because we need to think about the complexity and the nuance of each individual family. And that it might not have been safe to leave. And it might not have been safe to call the police. And it might not have been safe to go to shelter. And it might not have been possible to relocate. That we can't just assume a cookie-cutter relationship that every parent has the same resources available to her. And so the Court of Appeals talked to courts about please considering the complexities of each relationship and understanding what was available. Ultimately, and I found this interesting that Dr. Jaffe said this in another way, but I often say so many women stay in a domestic violence situation precisely because they think they need to protect their children, and yet that wasn't discussed at all. And as he said, the counterpart of that is they often leave because to protect their child. But if you're staying because, at least even with our Helen Hunt, if he doesn't beat Helen Hunt, he's going to go after Trevor. So you might stay as a way to protect your child, but the court was giving, or the ACS was giving no mind to that. And so ultimately, this thoughtful and wise Court of Appeals decision explained that we can't look at these cases in a vacuum, and we need to think about parenting in a very, you know, complicated way, and what were these parents doing to protect their children, even though it wasn't apparent to someone who is not in a victim of domestic violence, in a relationship of domestic violence. There were other other notable developments in the law, some good, some not so good, but I will. They're all in your handouts, and I know we're pressed for time, so I'll kind of move ahead to my next point, which is that we need to be thinking about how we use the law as a vehicle to change this culture that we have. Use the law in the way that Nicholson Court used the law, to say we need to bring awareness to these issues and use the law in a positive way. Instead of contributing to a culture of violence, let's use the law as an agent of change. So, what are some ideas? One step is even just increasing awareness. I mean, all of us in this room obviously are well aware of the epidemic of domestic violence. So I'm kind of preaching to the choir to some extent. But we need to bring that awareness beyond just the professionals who work in this field every day. And I truly believe that that early childhood education is so important. I believe that really to unhook in our child's minds the idea that somehow this power and control over another person is glamorous or sexy, or this somehow means he loves you more because he's stalking you more or texting you more. We need to unhook that early on so that when our children become teenagers and when our teenagers become adults, we can see that that's not the appropriate norm, okay? And I recommend doing this before kids are even dating. Before kids are even dating, get into those schools and educate about what's a healthy relationship. Don't listen to the, you know, what's on social media or what's in the music. Here's a healthy relationship. I talk about renorming. Renorming our versions of what's normal. Earlier I talked about statistics that showed that when women and men feel that domestic violence is appropriate, there seems to be a higher level of domestic violence in those countries. Listen to this somewhat comforting statistic. In Nigeria, for example, in 2003, 44% of women in Nigeria said it was okay for a husband to beat his wife. Yet, when legislation was passed that was anti-domestic violence, that showed domestic violence being a crime, 10 years later in 2013, the figure dropped to 21% who saw it as acceptable. Similarly, in Benin, the drop was from 39% to 10% over a similar period of time. In Haiti, 11% to 3%. So basically, they were polling the citizens of countries, 100 countries around the world, and saying, is it okay for men to beat women? And there was high percentages of yes. But when the law came in to show that this was against the law, those percentages came down as to what was acceptable. Even in our own country, former South Carolina Governor Nikki Haley was applauded because she created a task force just to change a culture in South Carolina, a culture of domestic violence. In fact, for whatever reason, that state had been one of the deadliest in our nation at the hands of men killing their spouses. And so she worked tirelessly to have legislature toughen penalties and work with changing this culture. So again, I really talk about transforming our perceptions of intimate partner violence and renorming what's the appropriate norm. The Department of Justice recently did some social norm research and launched some programs about engaging men in preventing sexual assault and domestic violence. They use social media combined with hands-on mentorship to have male leaders teaching about what's appropriate to girls and boys. Recently, I learned about even some social media or some sort of apps that were aimed to help decrease online dating violence. One of them is and I'm not sure I'm going to say this right, but they develop these things called call-out cards. And for example, when you're doing something inappropriate, this app will intervene. I'm not entirely sure how this works. But how this works, and I'm going to make sure my kids have this on their phone. If you text one too many times to the same number, the call-out card comes to you and says, "Congrats. With this last text, you've officially achieved stalker status." I don't know. But, you know, if that's what's going to work for our 10-year-olds and our 12-year-olds, I mean, that's going to make a lot more sense than me saying that's stalking to my child, right? In other words, these phone apps, it gives kind of the new norm campaigns clout. And the idea of it is they're trying to re-norm. They're trying to say to kids, like, that's not appropriate behavior. Let's do it this way. Again, we've certainly made tremendous strides, and as I mentioned, New York is certainly a true front runner. I hope that we can kind of brainstorm together and throughout the day to talk about more ways in which we can change the culture of domestic violence that we have lived in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Breger. I heard Professor Breger speak in Albany last year, and I am as struck this year as I was last year by the songs. It's just not as innocent as washing that man right out of your hair. A couple of comments, please, about the reference to gender, to culture, context. At one point, I was working with the Department of Preventive Medicine, School of Public Health, at the University of Illinois in Chicago, and I worked on putting in a grant working with the Navy, and it was about domestic violence. And one of the reasons we did not get the grant was that we were interested in including violence against men in the grant. Not the only reason, perhaps, but one of the cited deficiencies in the proposal. In terms of culture, at one point I worked briefly in Israel consulting with the minister against domestic violence, and Israel has done some pretty amazing things, like developing a system where instead of having to help women and children relocate and lose school placements, and they created shelters for men who had abused. I don't know the extent to which it continues to be a solution, but I do remember being really impressed when I visited one in Israel. But when I first got to Israel, I was told very clearly that Jews didn't hit their wives. But if they did, it had to be the Ashkenazi, the Western, you know. It couldn't have been the Western Hemisphere. It couldn't have been the Ashkenazi. It must be the Sephardim. And of course, at the time, there was this conflict between Ashkenazi and Sephardim in Israel that was only abated by the conflict between religious Jews and not-so-religious Jews. And so the world goes on. But it continues. I remember asking someone who I really respect to come and speak about same-sex violence. And her response, which I had to really think about to understand and empathize with, was that she was resistant because she didn't want to shine a light because of fear of homophobic backlash. And I had to respect that. I think the focus on numbers that was referenced both by Dr. Jaffe and by Professor Breger is incredibly important, and it doesn't minimize our focus necessarily vitally on abuse against men. But when I think about some of these numbers, and the reason we must focus is because of the truly horrifying numbers of assaults against women and children and also femicide. We must focus on these numbers. But we also, I think, must consider the number of adult men who perpetrate violence, who were physically abused or perhaps subject to excessive corporal punishment as children. So I really want to just sort of throw that out there, not as an excuse again, but as a way to really understand the numbers in our research. One thing that Dr. Jaffe said that I didn't have time to mention, I'd like to just briefly mention, because it was in materials that we have, talking about a heightened risk when a child is not, a child in the household of a family, is not the domestic violence perpetrator's child. And it occurs to me that when Dr. Jaffe talks about getting even with a parent by hurting the child, that Trevor may be safer than if there was a child who wasn't Bon Jovi's child, because there isn't that bond, that love, that attachment to perhaps mitigate against that type of rage and retaliation. So that was my thought about that. I would like the research to maybe explore that. I'd like to turn briefly and ask if Judge Block Rodman has a question or a comment.
Okay. With respect to that last comment?
No, with respect to Professor Breger's presentation.
Okay, well, first of all, having had a role in the last 25 years, first in the district attorney's office and then later in family court, having started in 95, right after the Domestic Violence Intervention Act, where absolutely the culture of law enforcement and the culture of the judiciary was very focused on this isn't our problem. Judge Townsend, Court Attorney Referee Schwanekamp, and I attempted numerous times as attorneys back then to educate law enforcement. There was a huge gap between the reception of domestic violence being a criminal justice issue for the recruits at the Law Enforcement Academy versus the trainings we did for supervisors. I remember Justice O'Donnell and I went to a captain and lieutenant's training in latter part of 1995, and I barely got out of there alive. I also recall in speaking to members of the judiciary who did criminal cases as well as matrimonial, that the concept of separating a person from their firearm was seen as a clear violation of Second Amendment rights by the judges who, when we started talking, because back then there was no automatic removal of firearms from the home as part of the order of protection. Several judges got up and walked out, and I'm sure Ms. Schwanekamp recalls, I'm not going to put names on it, but certainly, and we are still today in some of the rural areas, not just rural, but certainly there is a different focus on a firearm and my right to own it as guaranteed by the Constitution versus an advocate or an attorney requesting, whether it's from the DA's office or an attorney for the child or attorney from a petitioner in a custody case, requesting that firearm be surrendered as being, for lack of a better term, un-American. And that is the battle that continues.
Thank you. Dr. Jaffe, I know you have to scamper back over the wall, but would you like a final word?
Thank you. no wall. It just it was a scam, really. Electronic. Just briefly, I still have two rooms left in my basement. I've had a couple of requests during the break. Bad joke, sorry. All we have left is humor. I just want, actually, on the rural, I just want to make a comment. Actually, we just finished a study looking at rural versus urban homicides, and the presence of guns is more significant. Actually, where we find, we're working on, we're looking at a number of vulnerable populations, and particularly rural and more remote areas, guns are a way of life. It's really, it's embedded as really essential. It's sort of, it's beyond the Constitution. Just a, it's a way of life, and guns are obviously a high risk, but even more high risk in rural areas. And women are less likely to separate. There's also more addiction issues in rural versus, I mean, they're in both, but we found significant difference with access to weapons. So that's a significant issue. Like we do a lot of work now with even with family doctors talking to men where there's issues around depression or domestic violence, talking about the risk when guns are in the home. To me, and I use this analogy with doctors I train, I said, it's no different. If I go to my doctor and they tell me I should, for my own health, I should lose weight, you know, we don't mind telling patients that. The same way you have to be able to tell a client or a patient that having a gun in the house is going to increase the risk of suicide, you know, more than 15 times of homicide, you know, more than 10 times. So we have to have those frank conversations. I really appreciate that. And it's very hard. I do training with judges all over the U.S. And there's judges who actually violate federal laws. Like even I've been in debates with judges in Texas where the guns are seen as even with a history of domestic violence, even with threats, even with restraining orders, there's still resistance to even apply the law as we know it.
It's in New York State.
So it's prevalent. You asked a question, any other reflections before I leave town? I think there's a really, and so encouraged by the discussion that they're taking place. I'm really encouraged by the work of AFCC, and I just want to thank the conference organizers for inviting me. It means so much to be at a table to have judges speak frankly about the issues and to look at the work in the broader context. I'm so worried about our context. I have four sons, and I can tell you as a dad, every day I have to struggle to tell them, you know, to give them alternative messages. We're surrounded by violent video games, violence in the media, so I really appreciate the comments about really thinking about our culture and challenging our sons and our partners to think about different ways of being. It's a daily struggle, and I also think we should be, other than the important work in family law, I also think we should spend a lot of time in schools making sure healthy relationships is at the core. We have a program in our community called the fourth R. You know, for older people, the first three R's are reading, writing, arithmetic. The fourth R is relationships, healthy relationships, and we see that as essential for the curriculum. Most parents are concerned about safe and accepting schools, so I really want to encourage you, for those of you who are also trying to deal with staying hopeful is doing work in the area of prevention and working with schools. So again, thank you again for inviting me. I'm gonna, yeah, sorry.
Yeah, just a quick, I know you gotta go, so yeah. Quick question. And I'm gonna extend this into the lunch hour a little bit because Judge Kaplan's gonna speak to us briefly and then we're gonna be going down for lunch, so just hang in there with us for a bit. Real quick, Peter, I used to be a law and order junkie years ago before I had kids, and then I had to tell them not to watch it, and then I had to stop. But what I always felt bad for Elliot because his whole day was with horribly brutalized people and children and perpetrators. And so my question, I guess, is kind of a how bad is it out there question, because you're talking about staying hopeful and it's a critical message. So with respect to things like the base rates in the broad population of just say marital couples, the base rates, and maybe Dr. Leary will chime in, the base rates of coercive control violence, for example, compared with kind of reactive violence or self-protective violence, what are the base rates like out there in the general marital population?
It's There's not a simple answer, but because the research has changed, the questions that we ask have changed. The some encouraging news, there's sort of good news, bad news. The good news is that people are getting help earlier. So there are, in the past, there's research on women separated five times before the final break from a violent home. Women are more likely to report today than before, so the rates are going up significantly in terms of disclosure and leaving abusive relationships. So the rate of violence continues, but people getting help is encouraging, so people are reaching out more. So we've actually, and one of the ironies in the field, is we've saved more men's lives than women's lives. So a lot of women kill in self-defense after years of violence and abuse. And because of all the helplines and shelters and outreach, ironically, we've more significantly reduced the rate of men being killed by abused partners because they're getting out before the act of desperation. So there are some, there are some trends. I think there's much more awareness. There's much more prevention going on in schools, but many more people are talking about it. And I think the thing that keeps me hopeful, there's a new generation of judges and lawyers and mental health professionals. This is now more likely to be embedded in the graduate programs. It was never discussed when you and I were in school, Jeff. It was never discussed in law school, medical school. Law school, not as common, unless you had a really good professor who had a special interest, you really didn't address it. So I do think there's a new generation, so I continue to be hopeful, and much more outreach. I think my kids are much more involved. You know, there's much more focus in schools around healthy relationships, social justice. So there are encouraging signs.